I'd like to start with a shout out to the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, who is actively highlighting that we truly need a circular economy. And just before the climate conference in Egypt, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation published this picture that highlights that if you think of renewable energy, that is truly only half of the story, because we need to complete the picture with the circular economy. So for the energy transition, the materials transition, actually all the sustainability challenges that we face, we need to think circular. So with that mindset, think back a few years, maybe a few more years. Think of early Earth, think of Darwin describing this warm little pond that is described here, where these six key biogenic elements came together: carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And life originated on planet Earth because of these six key elements. Now, these six are essential for sustaining life on Earth. And actually, my proposition is that the exact same six elements are also the cause of global waste problems, indicated by these two big waves depicted on the right, so climate change and biodiversity loss. Now, from this cartoon, let's go to a more scientific picture. This picture highlights planet Earth, and if you think of a traffic light, green is good, orange, yellow, not so, and in the red, you know, immediate action is required. And so obviously climate change is on top, but if you think of other waste problems, sustainability challenges, these are also highlighted over here. So we always need nutrients for food production, for life, so phosphorus and nitrogen is depicted on the bottom. If you think of the ozone layer, we need to protect it. If you think of clean air in the atmosphere, clean water, everything is essential. And all of it is also interacting and leading, if something goes wrong, to biodiversity loss. Now, if you think again of these six elements, you can actually easily map them on this picture. CO2, methane, causing climate change, ammonia, nitrates, phosphates, essential nutrients, but if they're wasted in the environment, they cause also problems over there. So a picture says a thousand words, right? So if you look on the left, this is the Dutch nitrogen problem caused by the heavy industry, producing heat, I mean, at high temperatures, processes are run. So if fossil fuels are combusted, also nitrogen oxides are being produced. You can clearly see Rotterdam, Antwerp, and the Ruhrgebiet. So on the right, the Dutch nitrogen problem for ammonia is listed. This is directly due to the fact that our livestock is typically not going to the toilet, and their waste is freely entering the environment. So in this picture, you really can clearly see where our millions of chicken run around in Barneveld. You can also clearly highlight, this picture is taken from the atmosphere, from a satellite. You can clearly see where the millions of pigs are running around. Now, this is in the air, but also waste molecules can enter the waterways. So if you think of phosphate, if you think of nitrate, if you think of ammonia, all are also soluble in water and can cause also problems there, depicted here on the right with, you know, excess algae growth causing eutrophication. Now, actually, we know these problems for decades. There is an article in Nature in 1944 that highlights that the phosphorus cycle on a global scale is disturbing by the impact of humankind. So clearly, since then, nothing truly important has happened to solve these issues. So I'm more and more of a believer that we need radical change. Radical change because the current problems, waste problems, are caused by the linear economy, are caused by our linear thinking. So we need completely different new solutions to be able to steer into this circular economy. Now, if you think from a technology perspective, if you think of producing a battery or producing a plastic bottle, we rely on chemistry as an enabling technology. And since 25 years, the green chemistry principles exist that actually offer our guidelines to produce less waste, use renewable resources, use energy efficiency, But when I saw this, and I was thinking of the circular economy, I came to realize that these principles and these guidelines actually only are optimizing our current linear system, and that still produces waste. So if we think of going towards this circular economy to solve global waste problems, we also need to think circular. So we need to bend our linear economy, make it circular by introducing recovery, introducing recycling that ideally work together. And if you think of a plastic bottle, for example, or a battery, the first production cycle is not so much of importance. Are the resources fossil-based, renewable-based? Think of the second production cycle and the third and the fourth. Then, actually, in the circular economy, we start with the products. So if you think of designing products, actually, we should not only think about the resources. It's much more important to think of the products and make them, make the design such that you can actually recycle them. So that's basically the reason that by teaching green chemistry at university, we realized that we also need more principles. We need circular thinking also in the development of new technologies. So the key issue is, I would say, number seven, you know, the design of any single product so that it actually can behave nicely in the circular economy. And in 2019, if you look closely at number one, I still had some linear thinking, because I said use waste, but actually waste comes from the linear economy, and actually I should say use the product, collect the product, and use it again, recycle it again. So let's have a look at solutions. And for today, I would like to focus on the recovery and the recycling of nutrients that are directly linked to these waste problems. But I don't want to look at it as a waste problem, but let's look at it as an opportunity. Because if we can use these resources that are currently in the environment as starting points, we actually can solve the waste problem and locally create resources and products and so on. Have you seen this picture before? This is Hennig Brand. He is an alchemist, and in the 17th century, he was looking for the philosopher's stone. So he was quite desperate, because if I tell you what kind of experiment he did, you can imagine that he was quite desperate, wanted to produce gold, but in the end, he was boiling down liters and liters of urine in the presence of some sand and some carbon, and what he discovered was the element phosphorus. So this is actually the starting point of phosphorus chemistry, the phosphorus industry, and actually the use of this material also for the synthesis of high-value fertilizers. Now, what I like is that he did already apply green chemistry and circular chemistry, because he started off with a renewable resource, urine, that actually causes quite some problems now, because our cattle, our pigs, and chicken, they diluted in the environment. So to scale up the production of fertilizers from urine wasn't desirable in our society, I guess. So we went to the mines, and there is still plenty of it. But the problem is, if you start from phosphorus and nitrogen from the mine and convert it into fertilizer, and you do that in a linear fashion, you create waste. So once a fertilizer, always a fertilizer. So currently we're fertilizing our oceans. Now the solution is actually if we implement recovery and recycling. And so being inspired by Hennig Brand, there are actually some opportunities to do this. If you think of this scheme, then ammonia and phosphate are both soluble in water, hence they're part of urine. You can actually recover them quite easily by adding a metal like magnesium. So this is currently being done already at the industrial scale. But when I saw this, I wondered, okay, recovery is there. why isn't the recycling being done? Is this because of the purity of the material? And actually, we demonstrated this process at the Lowlands Festival a few years ago. So if you do the recipe, add magnesium next to main stage, ideally, and then you can recover both phosphorus and nitrogen from urine and get the material that is actually of suitable quality to allow recycling. Now, the material does not contain any cadmium or uranium that consists in phosphate that comes from the mines. But what is missing, or what was missing, is actually to use this material as resource. So that was why we went to the lab and started to use thruvite as a resource, as a renewable resource for the production of high-value fertilizers, depicted, for example, over here. So what we did, we developed a SysFos process there where you can create monoammonium phosphate from waste, from thruvite, and in the cycle, actually, the magnesium leftovers can go back to, for example, the wastewater treatment plants where more thruvite can be generated. So we started to close the phosphorus and nitrogen loop, and also the use of magnesium in this case is without any waste. So currently this process is being scaled up. The pilot is over here on this picture, and I'm quite proud of this because we really started with a few milligrams, and at the moment already more than kilos, hundreds of kilos are being cycled in the process, and that definitely is a good starting point to realize a circular economy for nutrients. Now, if you think back again to the origin of life, there are papers actually that highlight that thruvite could well be one of the key minerals containing nitrogen and phosphorus where actually life was originating. So it's actually a good choice that we also use the same material in our circular economy to closely loop nitrogen and phosphorus as key enabling nutrients. So with that, I hope I've shown you that we really need to think circular. And if you think of buying a product or think of a new technology or you want to develop them, always really think of it has to fit according to the rules and guidelines of the circular economy. So it really has to be circular. Thank you.